So, what's been happening since the last session we had?
Just school, basically.
Just school.
School what, stress, school with people.
And what about the homework I gave you? Something about looking up decision making, remember? Can you tell us why the subject of me giving you homework came up, just roughly speaking, not to any particular thing, but were you having some trouble making some decisions about things?
You're trying to help me become more clear and unconfused.
Well, decision making does what?
Basically makes you unconfused.
Makes you unconfused.
You're clear with your decision.
That's a pretty good way to put it. I don't think I've ever heard anybody quite put it that way. I mean, why would you be confused in the first place?
If somebody hit you with a subject that you didn't really know the answer to.
Well, that's right. So could you speak up a little? I wouldn't want my teacher to take off bad points. Professor, this is a good friend of mine. His name is Tyler, and I'm Lee, and due to our original camera being broken, this is basically what I look like now that I've ruined your day, sir. Tyler is, he may very well be my best friend. He may be very well be the only friend I have right now in my whole life. One of the reasons I say that is because he's the only one here. And he came here for one reason, and one reason only, really. Well, I'm not going to speak for him, but I think he came here to help me. So, I'm not sure if you saw the nodding agreement, but we do sort of have somewhat of rapport, although if I mention this to Tyler, and Tyler's honest, he'd probably say that I'm probably authoritarian. But it could also be the jerk word or the a-hole word or what else I could be right at times, simply because I'm just old and lonely, but I'm not isolated. I haven't gone that far yet. I have a CAT scan in 2 weeks for lung cancer, but other than that. So the last time we were together, you and I talked about decision making, and we were talking about mostly what you want to do for a living. So why don't you tell our professor, or tell the room, we're in a mock therapy session, right? That we're making believe and we're pretending like we were in a movie. But tell the room as loud as you can, or audible as you can, what your ambitions are for a career.
I've always been into the athletic side of life. Because I've always gone through difficulties where people think that I can't really do anything. And this all started when I hurt my knee back last summer. And the physical therapist that I went to told me, oh, you won't be able to do much sports again. And I came back from that and I said, no way myself. I can do better than this guy. I can get in his place and do better than that. And I came back and I'm more physically active and fit than I've ever been. And throughout that role of my last year, I've decided that I wanted to be a physical therapist and help people and encourage them that they can do better. I don't want to tell you, oh, you won't be able to do nothing again. Walk, run, be active. Because that's not true, because I've experienced it myself. That's why I want to take on the career as a physical therapist. Really help and encourage people.
So your motives, in my opinion, are honorable. I think that you're looking at a greater good of things. I also think that you like helping people. But then there's the work, right, of getting the license and the paperwork and the degree and, you know, the, dare I say, ball-busting work it takes to go through school, right? How are you doing with that? I mean, tell the professor or the room what it is you said when you walked in the door about the latest test you had.
Well,
I mean, you said you were mad. Well, that's one of the good things about therapy. You can get mad. You're allowed to do that. Many people don't know that. You're actually allowed to get mad. You were pretty pissed when you... You were pretty upset when you got in. We don't have a censor here, so I said a bad word. Anyway, what happened?
Well, the word for it is going to take so much effort and everything, and I understand that. But as he said, I have the right to get upset. I think I was more upset at myself and not the test that I failed.
So you failed a test today? And
with the studying that I went through for it, I felt as if I was prepared for it. But when I went in, I knew I didn't study hard enough. May it be 2 hours to 10 hours, wherever it might take you, you gotta go out and achieve your goals, even if you fail. Because then you can come back and learn from your mistakes. And achieve
them. What do you mean by learning from your mistakes?
I mean, basically, if you fail, get right back up and try again. It's just basically you're teaching yourself. It's a learning process for yourself throughout life. And if you go through everything and you fail one time and you give up, I mean, where are you going to get? Nowhere.
That's right. But also, what about if you keep failing over and over because you're learning, let's say, what the way a lot of people grow up, at least in my generation, we always learned the hard way. We called it, or later on in the century, because I was born in 1945, they called it... trial and error, you know, where you go through this and this whole thing where you go and you try to achieve something and it works out wrong because maybe you're not doing it efficiently enough or you're not using shortcuts that work better and make you more efficient as you go. You know what I'm saying? You've had some of that in your classes, like about efficiency and so on. It brings to mind, and I'm not trying to dominate the session as much as I'm trying to make a point and lay a foundation for the next 10 or 15 minutes here, that persons, well, in history anyway, persons that fail to understand their mistakes, they're condemned to repeat it over and over. And that's a hard thing for any man, or woman, or baby, or person, or dog, or even a snake. You know, they sometimes they know what to stay away from. You know, learning what not to do is not a very easy thing. So having laid that premise for a conversation, do you remember that I also gave you an additional piece of homework? Do you remember what that additional piece of homework was?
To study on the email you gave me?
No, right before that.
To print out a couple of documents on decision making?
Yeah, after that one and before the email.
I honestly don't.
Good. Just say it. It's not wrong. If you don't remember or you don't recall, nobody's going to judge you about that. Least of all, you wouldn't want to judge yourself, would you?
Right, because then that would put you down.
Well, it would put you down. Yeah. But I ask you to take note in the decision-making suggestion I made to you, just as a friend. I really don't like people struggling. And if you make decisions and they're well thought out, well, there's a way to think about it. I don't mean to sound pedantic or like I'm a teacher or anything. It's just that there are methodologies, are concepts that allow people to look at, say, the process of decision making and understand that decisions come down to choices, right? And let's say you had three choices to do something or not do something, right? Whatever choice you make, you're going to have to give up the others. Right. See, so you're already losing right there. You see, because you can't do everything. The trick is to make the right one. And I had mentioned the word, let the camera record your reaction and see if you recall. I have been mention the word discernment. Do you remember?
Right.
Yeah. Discernments, do you know what they might be? I mean, this is not a test. You can say anything you want. I mean, you know they're not dogs, right? What do you think discernment means?
I don't know.
Okay. Do you know what deliberation means? Like, say, for example, in the jury, for example. You know, a jury deliberates. You're aware of that, right? Or the teacher decides what grade they're going to give you. You know, not only based on your score, but also based on your participation.
Right.
Those are deliberations. And deliberations require discernments. They're specific, tiny little decisions or judgments that speak to the character of the entire situation. So that everybody gets treated equally, so to speak. That's the idea, anyway. Now, I'm not expecting you to learn that, because what I really want to talk about is what the heck do you think you're going to do, for example, when you get challenged in your schoolwork. I believe you said something to me about you've got to do something, I think this semester, about a physical therapist. Or something?
Right.
Talk about that for a minute. Talk about that for a little while. And also, don't be afraid to express if you feel bad about it or pressure. I mean, get it out now. I mean, it doesn't cost you anything, right?
Right.
So what's going on with this thing? You didn't sound too hot about it.
Well, the work is most definitely challenging. The work is most definitely challenging.
Well, describe what the work is.
The work is just many obstacles, and it's just so many things you got.
Wait a minute. What is it that your teacher is asking you to do?
He wants me to spend 10 hours with an actual therapist throughout a time at this semester and observe him and basically get a feel for then write a report on it and turn it into him.
You have to write a report.
And then that's how they
do
it.
That, and then you what get are you, a rocket scientist or something? Do you feel good about that?
I feel like it's necessary. It's just such a demanding. So just nursing, for an example, you got to get accepted into the program, and that requires a lot of hard work, such as many other subjects. Just like this, you got to get accepted into a program, so it's going to require hard work. And if you're not up to the task, then don't do it.
So, I guess you have some decisions you're going to be making, right? Would that be, would that involve who, what, where, and when? Since we know why already. So, what about the who, what, when, and where? Those are, once you have those pinned down.
Like with time management, that's an obstacle. If you're a busy person throughout your life, you got to know when to sit down, study, do your work. And you got to know when to make the right decisions and hang out with the right people when you got more important things on. Just like where. You know, you might not have all the requirements in that area. You know, so the best suitable area might be a library where you have tons of research and tons of helpers, or it might be with the physical therapist itself. And they might help you.
Well, I'll tell you what I think, that if I'm understanding this correctly, your teacher wants you to go into a physical therapy session with a person and observe it being done. Is that basically what is going on?
Right.
And then to write about your experience.
Right. Okay.
Well, what's the matter with somebody giving you a referral or a name? I know a therapist you can go and see. And he'd likely take you in. He's a little weird, because he does deep relaxation therapies, and a lot of time he works in a dark room, but he works with people that have been in automobile accidents, sports injuries, you know, when people like throw a basketball and the basketball comes back and hits their thumb and jams it, you know, he works with people like that.
That's where the question, who comes in, you want to pick your best suitable option that you have. You don't want to get somebody that's not going to help you.
Well, am I helping you to reflect on, you're probably not going to find the therapist in the library. That's probably going to be somewhere in Picayune or Hattiesburg. Right? Somewhere that 100 miles. That's something you can go in an hour or so and be done with. But you only have to go one time.
I could go one time, or I can go through multiple sessions, because I have to complete 10 hours.
Oh, okay, yeah. Well, that could be 10 different patients.
And that's a lot of more observing, because, you know, that could be 10 different incidents, you know, maybe a spinal, sports, physical,
right,
automobile accident, for instance.
Right. So, let's say that you had all this field experience. Are you going to get a certificate for that? Or is it just part of the class?
It's part of the class. Well, I personally do not know. I might, but I know it's part of the class. I might get a certificate that says that I've made it into the PTA field.
Well, at any rate, you're going to get credit. So how do you feel about your keeping in mind that we may have to deliberate, like we just did, no problem, right?
So right.
Some sort of summarizing that we're doing pretty good here, right?
Right.
You seem to be having a genuine understanding versus you're not struggling much, right?
Right.
So let's see what we do with this next subject about struggling. How do you feel about your college environment? You know, social, the girls, all the things that people do, what happens on campus, whether it's music or whether it's picnics or whether it's, God forbid, other things that we can't talk about. But how do you feel overall about, I mean, you're fresh out of high school, right?
Right.
You're a freshman. So this has to be a change.
It really is.
And you can also talk about your friends. Like, I know some of your friends. I know John, and I know Trey, and I know Michael. They're very good friends of mine. And they're all facing the same thing as you, right? Freshmen in college, I don't know what to tell you. So what how are you handling your schedule these days? Well, do you have any time for yourself?
Really, my time for myself is just seeing me achieve. Because that gives me pleasure in myself, because I know I'm using my time right. That's where it goes back to time management with who, where, when. And decision-making, actually. Because if you don't make the right decisions, if you go get drunk at a tailgate football party that they have on college one night, you're not going to be ready for that.
That's now you're answering my question. That was an open-ended question. You're allowed to say anything you want. I know what happens at football fields on Friday night. But Saturday morning's a different story, isn't it?
Right.
Or if you have a football game on Sunday night and 8 o'clock class in the morning.
Oh, yeah.
So how do you feel the facilities at your college?
I feel like my facilities are very helpful. They have multiple tutoring institutions, multiple reliable sources. For one, that's just if you decide to use them, which I personally have decided, and it's personally helped me out throughout my first 9 weeks of school.
9 weeks of school. Have you declared a major?
Physical therapy.
Why did you do it so early? You know, you don't have to do that until you finish your unders and transfer. Why did you do it so early?
I feel like if you set a foundation of what you want, then your goals will be easier to accomplish. You can't just set a goal and have no idea behind it.
How do your goals align with your history, geography, English, and math skills?
Personally, I don't. Their skills might be important for that subject.
Well, yeah, you have math in everyday life.
Right.
Geography has to do with territory. Right. All bodies have territory that you do therapy with. Somebody breaks your leg, you don't massage their arm.
Right.
And so on. That's a discernment or a distinction I'm bringing up in that I sort of learned the hard way, trial and error, that when I started my understudies, I was 49 years old. When I finished high school, I went to work and had children. You know, Mr. Workaday World. And then when I retired, I went back to school, and I didn't know what the heck I wanted to do. Because all I'd ever done was work, you know. And then it got to a point where I thought I had to pick a major. And by the time it took me 2 years to get my math and all that stuff out of the way, I sort of still didn't know. And everybody that talked to me, including even a friend of mine that was advisor to the dean, I said, that's what it's for. You're supposed to enjoy the first couple of years of college and bust your butt to learn the basics. And then take what you learned from the basics and put it into a goal. Because I think your goal is quite honorable. But I'm not so sure how sustainable it might be without basic math, you know, literature. How do you feel about literature? How do you feel about
literature?
Stories, you know, stories, novels, and like The Color Purple or whatever, you know, just what's your favorite book?
My favorite book was The Hatchet. No, I never really thought about it that way. Never really ever thought about it, to be honest.
Well, how do you feel about literature? As a subject.
I feel literature is very important because if you go into an interview and you're like, oh, swag, what's up, homie? mean, you're not going to get hired. You want somebody who's going to be clear and understanding to the subject and can talk clearly.
So you mean the context of something?
Context.
Yeah. So how do you like, do you like math?
I do like math.
You do like math.
That's a big part of problem solving and everything else. Just like with, if you went into construction or...
Right. What do you know about quadratic equations? You did those in high school algebra, didn't you?
A few. That was a touchy subject in 10th grade. They've changed math now. You got Common Core and all
that's
this.
That's right. Well, I don't want to get into Common Core. That'll get take us into politics. But what happened? What would happen to you, I guess, as we're about the middle of the session here, what would happen to you if you decided that you didn't want to be a physical therapist or a person in sports medicine? What would you do then? Do you have a backup plan?
Honestly, no, because when I set out for a goal, I try and do whatever it takes to achieve it. Most of the time, I get it. If not...
Well, so what if you were in a boat race? What do you call those things? Triathlons or something? What do they call those boat races?
I really don't.
Well, what if you were in a boat race and the boat had a hole in it and you sank and couldn't finish the race?
Basically, I have two options, or three. You can try again, fix it. You can go into another one, or another sport, or you can just give up, sit down, do nothing.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure there's many more options, but those are the main off the top of my head.
You mentioned tailgating. Would you like to give us your in-depth opinion on it as a observer of the stuff you see?
It's basically like a party at a football game. In the back of a truck, grilling out, drinking. Some might be smoking. Childish actions, basically.
Childish actions. So now, we've covered a little bit about your career ambitions. We've covered a little bit about college. Has there been any financial stress in it?
Actually, there has. With everything hitting you at once, because I personally don't have a job, so I rely on my dad to help without college. Throughout college, and he pays for my gas, my food, my living expenses, basically. And it does get to be a hassle because I'm old and I feel like I can get out there and get a job and support it. But then again, I'm scared that I might fail at it.
Well, that makes me think of something you talked to me about earlier about overachieving. Is that what you said?
Right.
What did you say that you were an overachiever or something like that? What did you say?
I said I don't like to fail. I want to get out there and try it the best I can. But that's where my mind comes in. It's like, oh, you can't. So I get scared and I never really tackle the task. It's kind of like with the big exam that I've been studying for. I'm scared to tackle it because I don't know the outcome. And my depression and my doubt will get to me.
Okay, well, that's understandable. What role does study have its play in that, you think? You know, setting aside time to study.
Well, as if that's basically you preparing yourself for that task.
What about studying the subject itself? Which class are you struggling with the most?
English, probably.
English. Are you talking about vocabulary? You're talking about writing? You're talking about reading? What are you talking about?
Writing.
Writing. Yeah, I sort of have that problem myself. Have you had to do anything with MLA yet?
Yes.
So what confuses you about MLA?
Nothing really confuses me about it because it's a style, but I got tackled with this the other week when I wrote my essay because I've always thought there was one type of MLA, but there's many more.
Well, it's a style. Yeah. And styles are not to be copied, they're to be stolen. Stolen would mean, at least figuratively speaking, that you adapt your own way of interpreting it and see if you can get what you can get away with. You know, you just don't want to go too far. You understand the minimum? Do you understand the system itself, MLA? You have a thing called works cited.
Right.
And in that works cited, What are the things that always are the same all the time?
The dates.
That's one.
And the style.
No.
You got a journal.
No, it's not called the style, but you're right. The journal, or the book, or the magazine, or the television program, right? Those are the publications. See, those are the sources of the publications. Like if you get an article from Time Magazine, it comes from Time Magazine. Right? You get an article out of the library, it comes from the book you got it from and the article you got it from, right?
Right.
So you have, well, what else do you have?
You have your MLA style, and then you have many other styles to like.
Now we're talking about under the work cited, you have the title, right, of the book, or the title of it. Well, what if I just run this by you real quickly and maybe you can get it for the rest of your 2 years?
All right.
Because after that, you're going to get into things like APA, right, which is basically the same thing. It's author, date, title, and anything else about where it came from. It's going to be somebody published it in London, or you got it off the internet, or you got it from the magazine, or you got it from the library. But it's author, date, and title.
All right.
So you can get any book. You go into Miss D's library right now and get any book, and you will see a title, and you will see an author, and you will see a publication date, and it will tell you where it was published. Those are the only four things that exist in MLA, APA, or any other of them. There isn't anything else. It took me 8 years to learn how to do that, to figure out that it wasn't a style as much as it was a way to document in an evidentiary way where this stuff comes from, who wrote it. It's like a who, what, when, and where thing.
Right.
So that's a good association to create. So having that little tutoring advice or whatever, will that help you become a better writer? You know, once you get a chance to go back and look at it in your paper, right?
Right.
Will it help you become a better writer?
It will.
Will being a better writer help you become a better therapist?
Maybe in certain situations with it.
Well, in therapy, don't you have to write evaluations? Don't you have to write progress reports?
Yeah. Right.
But you wouldn't necessarily need MLA in that.
Right.
So, do you understand what happens inside when you're writing it in your essay? You have to put that frenzy in there, don't you? And then you have to put, what is it, the author and the date, right? With maybe a comma in between. And then close the parenthesis. Well, you just take out the works cited sheet. Right. The works cited sheet is the authentic source of your work. So if you're using somebody else's work, you want to make sure you're giving them credit for it. Right. That's basically it. And it gets you points. You know, when you go to get your, say, accomplish your goals, you have a lot more confidence since you know what's going on, and you can just write somebody a, let's say, a prescription. I'm not talking about medication, am I? But you know, here's what I'm the therapist, here's what I want you to do. So let's say you had a car accident victim that had a problem with their shoulder that was causing a problem in their left shoulder that was causing problem in the right leg.
First of all, you said I'd have to observe to figure out the main cause of what's causing the pain. You know, because they could be back to the back and cause unstability and cause pressure and
balance, rotation, right? Things like that. Right. Think you're learning this in school, right?
Right
now. So what is your professor telling you these days about what kind of therapist he thinks you might be? Have you had discussions with him about it?
I have not.
How about this other professor you talk about a lot? When we first met, you told me about this professor that talk to you about all this nonverbal behaviors, and who was that person?
That was kind of like a life teacher, I guess you can say. She's the one who's going to help you, basically what you're doing, helping you with your goals.
But were you in a class of his, or is this somebody you just knew?
I'm in a class.
And what class is that?
It's like an orientation, but like lifestyle class at the same
okay,
time.
Okay, I understand. Yeah. Well, it's a general to get the feel for being in school, right? But you seem quite taken by him, that he was pretty smart, that he knew a lot. Right. What were the seven things he told you?
He gave me tips on time management, goal setting, decision making, basically all the stuff that we've gone over. Things to just help you become smarter and more confident with your decisions and the way you do your life.
Oh, and the way you do in your life. So you're telling me that if you learn all this stuff pretty good now, when you get to be 50, well, you'll have it, won't you? But if you don't learn it now and you get to be 50, you won't have it, will you?
Right.
Well, which one do you think?
I would agree.
So how do you feel about I have to look at the clock. I can't even remember what time we started, but I think we're about 40 minutes in. What do you think about this session? And do you think are you at the point where you can give yourself some homework? You know, new things that you want to think about or play around with? You know.
I would like to learn some new strategies that help me throughout my career in achieving these goals.
What do you think about this session here?
This session really opened my mind with some new things. Like I said, you brought new statements and subjects that I've never really come across or sat down to think about. And it's really opened my mind to more options and choices that I can take in certain situations.
Is there anything that you can pinpoint in our session that you think might stick with you for that? Like one particular topic or one particular thing that we said together?
The decision making, most definitely.
So how do you feel about decision making today as opposed to how you felt about it, let's say, before you went into college?
Before I went into college, it was kind of an up and down thing. I never really knew what to do. I was careless. And it bit me in the butt the first couple of weeks, and then I had to flip it around. Make the right choices instead of going out to parties, tailgating, and all this other time-consuming things, because that won't help you.
So you're sort of learning what author, date, and title means.
Right.
It's not just about books, is it? It's organization. That is an organizational system, just like decision-making is an organizational system, no?
Right.
Have you ever considered, well, you're going to have to take at least one psychology course before you get out of college, right? There are classes that are only about decision making. I mean, there are tons, well, not tons, but there are ways to look at it, like you can throw darts at it and always get the right answer. You know, of course, that's fine in a classroom, but it doesn't always work that way in real life.
Yeah, just like being open-minded. If you're not right. open to one choice that may be the easiest choice, you're basically shooting yourself in the foot.
Okay, now that having said that, and now that we're going to close the session up here in a second or so, how do you feel about the concept of thinking on your feet rather than one thing at a time?
Being more rational, probably.
Maybe. But what if you're going too fast and you trip? Like Michael the other day said that he got a little twitch here because he overextended in one of his laps in the pool. No, you're lifting concrete bags. Those are all tiny little incremental decisions, are they not?
Right, because if you rush, you'll bust one of the bags. You don't want
to
do that.
Right. I think the point I'm trying to make is decision-making isn't always about just picking a choice generally. Sometimes what happens is the choice is will give you the answer, but let's say it takes you 2 years longer.
That's where time management comes in.
Right. Well, you might be good in sales. You might be good as a sports broadcaster. I mean, you're young enough that you don't have to pin yourself down to just one thing.
It's another thing I never really thought about. I kind of hit college and I was like, I want to do one thing and I just want to do that. I was never, like I said, open-minded to other choices. You know, because that might not be for me. That's not what I was made to set out and go. Like you said, I could be a sports broadcaster one day.
Or you could go through therapy or even be in sports themselves. And then when you finish that, then you could do sports.
That's right.
And that would be, you'd have to know communications. You know how to report ethically and fairly, you know, without regard to race, color, and creed, and sex, and all that stuff.
Right.
The diversity issue.
It's a lot of problems people have nowadays, too.
Yeah, see, because it's not just injuries that related to an injury you have. A lot of times people just can't cope with life emotionally. They get, I don't want to use a psychological term, but they get anxious. Well, anxious is not psychological. Anxiety is.
I get anxious. So I personally know what you're talking about.
Well, what do you mean by that? That you personally get anxious? I mean, if you get exes, it is personal, isn't it? Every exes moment I've had been personal. Talk about that for a second.
Well, I feel it's getting anxious. It just, you're overthinking. You just, you want to do. And when you fail, you're like, what did I do wrong? You didn't sit down and think. Maybe you had other options. Maybe you had another way of going through it.
Well, I'll be dang. You're deliberating. Look at you, aren't you? Catch yourself doing that. It's a wonderful place to be. To just be able to make little tiny little discernments where you slow yourself down just enough to say, hey, that's the way.
Right.
Yeah, there you go.
See, because maybe today, I was so anxious to get this test done. I never really thought about it. I got to get it done. I got to make a good grade. And I came out of it, I didn't make a good grade. I sat there, I was, man, what did I do wrong? I never sat down and thought, hey, I could have had other options of ways of studying. You know, maybe I should have studied longer, sat down and figured out
the problem. Well, I hate to burst your bubble. What if you failed again?
Get back up and try again. That's how I've always been raised.
And if you can't get up again?
Try a different way.
That will work. That will work. And that's the hardest part, isn't it?
Right.
Figuring out how to do it differently without breaking out too far.
Right. It's like having two doors. One's locked, but you know what's back there. You just want to keep on getting, you're not going to work. But you got this door that you've never even looked at, and it's open. Yeah. And it leads to the same thing.
Isn't that what's that phrase they use in church? When God closes, when the door closes, God opens the window. I think that's something I learned in church when I was younger. That's sort of what you're talking about. Is that when a door closes, a window opens. It means there's always another opportunity.
Right.
But only if you're looking. Right.
If you're sitting around doing nothing, you're the only one to blame yourself.
That's right. Is there anything you'd like to say to my professor? Because someday you're going to be in a position where you graduate from college. I'm in a master's program. He's a PhD. He works in Canada. He does, as far as I know, the most wonderful work any human being could do. He's probably frustrated most times in his work. Most good professors are burnt out people. You know, they get into it because they care about people, what you were talking about. What would you say to our professor about this session, if you just talk straight to him? You could just call him Mr. Professor, would be fine. His name is Amy.
Mr. Amy? Professor Amy? I don't know. I've never really gave my opinion to an expert before. But if I had to give some tips of my own, would basically be what we talked about throughout this conversation and this study, basically. Time management, goal setting, making the right choices, and being open-minded. Because as he said, you might be, a lot of professors are stressed and aggravated a lot. Some of the decisions you might be taking are making you aggravated because you can't get through to it, you know? If I had to say keep one thing in mind, it would just have to be stay open-minded to all of your choices. There are so many doors, so many ways to do things. And I hope you spread this knowledge out. Because it can really help a lot of people. It really can.